Well, hi everyone. We'd like to welcome you to our webinar, Protecting Against Complex Email Attacks. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Sunil Chowdhury. I'm the product marketing manager here at Symantec. And I'm going to kind of moderate through this webinar, present a little bit and kind of help with the questions. Before we go into the presentation, I'd just like to remind any of you who haven't used the BrightTalk platform in a while, or if indeed you're new and joining us today, just a few little bits of housekeeping. So we intend this to be an interactive session. We won't be able to hear you, unfortunately, but we'd love to get your questions. So anytime you have a question, please just ask away and we'll capture that. If we can answer it there and then, we will. If not, we definitely want to make sure we have time to do that at the end. If you've not already found it, there's an attachments tab underneath the panel. And we've put some links to some of our product information and some blogs and analyst reports, which I think you'll find useful. At the end of the webinar, we love feedback, so we're going to ask you to rate the webinar. It's as simple as clicking however many stars you wish to give us, but also giving us any comments as well. And you know, before we switch our webcams on and just say hello in person, I just also wanted to say that today's recording will be recorded. There's also a copy of the slides available in the attachments tab. And if you do want to see the recording or share it, you just need to share the BrightTalk link that you've currently got, and that will give you access to the session. So with that out the way, let's just... if I just stop sharing the slides and we can introduce the presenters. Sarita, I think your webcam's, my webcam's just switched off for some strange reason. Good, okay, well, let me wave. I'm Sunil Chowdhury. As I said, I'm part of the product marketing team here as well. And Roberto, maybe you can introduce yourself and then we'll go to Sarita.
Hello, hi, my name is Roberto Monteiro and I'm one of the product managers for the email.cloud product.
Hello everyone. My name is Sarita Chadlavada. I am the product manager for emailsecurity.cloud.
Brilliant. Great. Well, I'm going to put back the slides and we'll just tell you a little bit about the agenda we're going to cover. So we talked about complex email threats. What I'd like to do is just share a little bit of data. We'll keep it not too heavy, not too many statistics. Share some of the latest insights from the FBI cybercrime report. I think that's relevant to what we're seeing. And also then talk about, and I'll bring Sarita in to do this, to share some of the insights from our own team of experts and analysts, particularly with what's been happening about COVID. You've probably been on hundreds, probably feels like thousands of webinars. Everyone's talking about COVID. Everyone's very well aware of working at home. In fact, you would have just seen that with ourselves, you know, various different setups. And I think we're getting quite used to that style. But that has led to opportunities. So I think it's right that Sarita talks about that. All throughout this webinar, we're going to talk about some of those cybersecurity implications. We've brought, sort of broken each of the major threats we've seen into kind of five brackets of what's at stake and what you can do about it. Of course, we're going to take the opportunity to tell you how Symantec helps address that. And we're going to share with you a lot around the email portfolio. You'd expect that with the experts we have from the email product management team as well. But we do want to make reference that email, you know, as we know, is only part of the entire picture. It's an important part and as a threat vector. But there are protections that go beyond email. And we just want to indicate a couple of areas there. We're not going to go too heavy into that, but I think it's right and fair that we show the breadth. And then to keep things simple, we're going to give you three recommendations. We're going to intersperse this with different voices. We're going to be speaking at different times. And we've also got some really interesting and clear demos to share with you. So with that all said, why don't I move to the next slide and just give you this very simple picture around something called BEC or business email compromise. So I'm sure many of you are familiar with the concept. This is an attack type, which has been going really since about 2013. What we're showing here is every year the FBI publish a report about internet crime, and they focus on number of victims and the dollar losses. Now, there are some other numbers we'll talk to later around BC, but this is really kind of an annualized view of internet crime losses. And the purple line at the top shows roughly over the last four or five years, growing from $1 billion to $3.5 billion a year of internet losses. Really no surprise going up, and you know, I'd be really curious to see what happens in 2020. But if you look at the ratio of BEC, you know, in 2015, 22% of all of those dollar losses were down to BEC. That's been growing and growing faster than the total internet crime losses. And now we're at a point where half of all financial losses through internet crime is as a result of BEC. So no surprise, this is a very big issue that customers are caring about and want to know how to solve. And as we go through this, we'll make sure, we'll kind of explain some of the difficulty and complexity around BEC and what can be done around that. Just to, if you're not familiar, really, you know, in the beginning, as I said, 2013, BEC attacks were kind of focused on spoofing or impersonating senior staff. So pretty typically, you'll see this example email on the right. You know, you'd get an email from your CEO or CFO or some other senior officer within your organization. Effectively, a very convincing story. They're traveling and there's a deal to close and they need your help to process a transaction. And they're relying on, if you like, staff obedience, if that doesn't sound too weird, to kind of process those transactions and people to act quickly and maybe not to question that instruction. That's evolved over the years to the things you see highlighted in red, you know, personal email compromise, fake legal email requests, particularly in America, around tax data, around employees. Recently, we've seen attacks around gift cards. You know, I'm at an event, I need you to go and buy 30 $200 Amazon gift cards as giveaways, just scratch off the activation coupons and send those to me. Even doing things with real estate. And more recently, what the FBI report was talking about is almost this mass attack of impersonating employees to go back to the payroll departments and say, oh, just before you pay me next month, can you just change my deposit account? All of this has added up to a big problem. So I've said, you know, annually, the FBI were reporting about, you know, $1.77 billion. Actually, if you look at the total costs of BEC, you know, when I first started talking about this, that number in white and at the bottom would have been $5 billion, then $12 billion, now at $26 billion. So it's growing quickly. And you really got a sense of that. If I quickly flick back with this chart, you can see that scale of growth. So no surprise, this is a big issue and one that people are very interested in. Sarita, maybe if I bring it over to you to talk about, you know, this two things you've been seeing from our analysts, and then I know Roberta is going to talk more about what we can do about BEC and some of the controls.
Sounds good. Thanks, Anil. So I would like to start off by talking about a few key trends in the threat landscape, in particular about BEC as well as URL-based attacks. These generally fall under social engineering type of attacks. So let's talk about the first threat, which is business email compromise, BEC. As you correctly pointed out, Sunil, these emails are generally highly targeted emails sent to employees, typically in finance department, by scammers who masquerade as senior executives within the company. Emails are text-based and usually are urgent requests to carry out large wire transfers or send sensitive information. And scammers, they may send multiple emails, first to build a rapport, and then in subsequent emails, tell the victim to make a wire transfer to a private account. So that's the nature of BEC. As far as the second threat goes, we have URL-based attacks. We are seeing that these are increasingly becoming common. Attackers or scammers are attacking through a browser is very easy, and any user can be a potential target. And depending on the nature of the attack, compromising a system or making a user give away their sensitive information, such as credentials, is as easy as getting them to visit a compromised website. So URL-based attacks are increasingly becoming very common in the threat landscape. I have a couple of examples here. One is of BEC, which shows a text-based email, no attachments, no URLs, no phone numbers, etc. And then a second example here of URL-based attack, where we see an email spoofing Netflix, and essentially with an embedded link. And if a user clicks on the link, they will be taken to a spoofed Netflix website that will ultimately ask for phishing credentials, credentials from the user. Now, one of the other trends that I also wanted to talk here about is COVID. As we also know that COVID-19 is an unprecedented global crisis, and it is continuing to cause apprehension on a global scale. But it has also been responsible for massive change. It has been responsible for this rapid digital transformation. So people working from home, this presents a golden opportunity for threat actors to introduce fraudulent campaigns to deceive people while they're at their most vulnerable. They employ BEC and URL-based attacks, even using COVID-19 as a excuse. Now, in terms of, I'd like to break down the problem of BEC and URL-based attacks a bit more in detail. So BEC emails are a problem because they do not generally look like a spam email. They typically, as I mentioned, do not contain attachments, URLs, or any commonly known bad senders. They are usually short emails under 8 to 10,000 bytes with very short subject lines. They contain keywords such as transfer, remit, urgent, etc. And they generally appear to come from a company executive. So it is really hard for organizations to detect these BEC emails because they look like any other good email. For example, if a bank wants to detect messages that come from a free email account containing keywords such as wire transfer, they might end up blocking both BEC as well as legitimate emails. So that makes this problem of BEC very challenging to solve. So to mitigate these type of attacks, BEC attacks, organizations or customers generally have to consider various protection methods, such as blocking user email impersonation, enforcing sender authentication, that is to only get trusted emails from trusted senders. They need to increase security awareness so that employees are able to spot phishing emails quickly, and have certain control points to check for sensitive data that leaves their premises. So these are the various requirements for a good email-based security solution. Similarly, let's break down URL exploitation issue a little bit further. Generally, secure web gateways, they do a good job in detecting and allowing access to known good sites or blocking access to known bad sites when it comes to URL-based protection. But the problem is, what do customers do when there are uncategorized sites and risky sites that are delivered via email? So a typical customer must choose between blocking these uncategorized sites, and they may potentially then, it may lead to negative productivity because some of the sites may be valid, or they may have to maintain whitelist policies. They may have to have processes for verifying these risky sites, etc., which are cost intensive. Or their other choice is allow uncategorized sites freely, but then that leads to the risk of infections and breaches. So they have to deal with that after the fact. So this situation with URL-based attacks can get challenging because there are every day millions of websites, domains, and subdomains that are created. And most of them exist for less than 24 hours. And hence, it's very hard to assess the nature of riskiness of a given URL. So in terms of dealing with URL exploitation issues, organizations therefore must consider solutions that can provide real-time data on URL safety, solutions that use artificial intelligence and advanced image analysis to detect spoofed websites, and ultimately they need to be ready to isolate risky URLs in real time. So those are the key requirements for a good email security solution in combating the URL exploitation issues. Now, with that, I would like to turn it over to Roberto for to talk about Symantec solution for BEC.
Thank you, Sarita. So in following up with what has been brought forward regarding BEC and URL threats, so we can bring forward so four base steps to help tackle BEC. So first one, we have account takeover, where basically someone manages to get access to your account. So it manages to get access to take your password and basically start impersonating your own email. So here we have some basic steps. So starting, for example, with multi-factor authentication, okay? And email threat isolation to stop those bad links before they manage to take your data, before they manage to take your credentials. We then have impersonation. So impersonation is something that has been growing. So someone pretending to be someone else. So we generally see this when someone pretends to be someone from the management team, CEO, CFO, someone that whenever you see that name on an email, the name itself carries weight, carries presence. So you're more likely to carry out an action just by seeing that name. So with that, so we do have impersonation controls to help with that section. Then we have to screen out scams. So here we have technologies in place, heuristics, and our own BEC scam analyzer to help target and stop these emails before they reach out to the users. But as it has been mentioned by Sunil and Sarita, a lot of these emails, they arrive and they are in essence good, or they start as good. This is where the big picture becomes ever more important. So to reach out into the analytics, so instead of just focusing on the strictly bad, the emails that we know are bad, through analytics, we can expand, and through corroboration of what's good and what's bad, we can expand the image. As nowadays, more and more emails that present themselves as good happen to not be. Okay. And lastly, we have the security culture. This one generally resides on education, as a big pillar of security is the user. So an educated user goes a long way to keep you secure. A user that knows the difference or knows to check a bad link. Okay, so from here we can use, for example, email tagging to indicate that an email is external. So that if an email arrives pretending to be CEO, why is it coming from the outside and not using the internal systems? Okay. We also have, for example, available phishing readiness. So this is a training tool where you can send simulated phishing, simulating adware to your users and see who falls for it, and then run assessments and then push training onto those users. Okay. Now, if we continue, Now, within BEC, so we can see several layers to help fortify our protection. So we have, so let's go from left to right. So email fraud protection, so to help block fraudulent emails. Here, the focus is more your branding. So how is your image being used on the outside? So it's not just what targets you, is what damage it causes when your image is used without your consent. Okay, so this is where the enforcement of records becomes important. So to fortify your SPF, to always sign your emails with a DKIM key and also enforce your DMARC records. Okay, so even if you're not ready to enforce your records for your own domains, do enforce the checks on every email you receive inbound. Okay. So now we have then the section of, again, the BEC, where we're going to be looking for lookalike domains, lookalike pages. So we will rely on historical data to also detect and target those particular pages. So as new pages are generated all the time, so if we see that there's a commonality between a new lookalike page of Office 365, so we already know to target that, okay? And now brings us to impersonation controls. So this is where the name of someone is taken over. So generally, these names, they tend to be public. So, and the first page that a spammer will use is your own corporate page. So generally, your own corporate page gifts to spammers all or most of the information they need to start these attacks. And since the names, the positions, so it paints a good picture of what they need to use. Okay. So this will bring me to the demonstration of EIC. Okay, so email impersonation. So what you can do to help counter this type of abuse. Okay, if you mind me, just bear with me so I can share my screen. So as you log into your email.cloud account, okay, EIC is available with the base product, okay, with the safeguard bundle. So the vast majority of you will have it. Okay, so it's found under your email security services, email impersonation control. Okay, so the tool is fairly straightforward. So our goal was to make it as simple as possible. So you know the names you want to target, and that's pretty much it. So at the start, so you can define an action. So what do you want to be done to the emails? So in our example here, I defined a subject tag to be placed at the start of the email subject line. So here for our example, I defined three hypothetical names. So a John Miller to be our CEO, a Sarah Peterson to be our CFO, and a Sophia Gomez to be our COO. So these are three hypothetical names. When inputting the names into EIC, try to be as complete as possible. There's no need for you to input variations, as the system will already do that for you. So I don't need to input John Miller, Miller John, John M. So all of those is already taken care of. So all that we ask is for you to be as complete as possible. So if the name, looking at our first name, is John Miller, so don't input it as John M, because that way we don't really know what the M stands for. So always try to be as complete as possible, okay? Now, I went ahead and I sent a few emails, okay, with the different variations, and we can see the outcome, as we can see. So we just have three names, John Miller, Sarah Peterson, and Sophia Maria Gomez. Okay. So I went ahead and I sent a few emails and I changed things around a little bit. Okay, so here on our first example, that was the most straightforward, just John Miller. So straight in the display name. And you can see our tag was added. So this one is fairly easy. We then move it onto the email. So it will check both the display name and the email section. So as long as it finds the name somewhere, it will go ahead and trigger. But we may have situations where you want to approve something. Okay. So in this particular example, here, this John Miller, I approved his hypothetical personal email. Okay. So if we bring it back here, in terms of approved senders, we have three options. You can do IPs or IP ranges, an envelope sending domain, or a personal email address, an envelope email address. And here we have his personal email, and we can see a tag was not added. Similarly, the same here with Sarah, where I approved the sending domain. So here, let me bring it back to the portal. Now we can see the other domain.com is approved. And that was the sending domain. So a tag wasn't added. Now let's look as things start to change. So if you look now here at our third name, we can see that the name starts changing. So now we have a Sophia M. Gomez. So the middle name has changed. So it's no longer in its complete form, but nonetheless, it is still triggered, it's still found this, is still trying to impersonate Sophia. As we continue, our next one, for example, the middle name disappeared altogether. So, and it's still found it. So you, in this case, go back here. We have our Sophia Maria, and we can see that I didn't need to add the Sophia Gomez by itself. So you already knew, okay, Sophia Maria Gomez, some of the names may be optional. And that's what we get here, a trigger again. And as we also know, a lot of email systems organize names in the reverse order as well. So we can have surnames first and the names after. So an AIC also accounts for those swaps. Okay, so here, not only we have a swap, we also have the Maria converted into an M. So we also have its initial. Okay, and once again, we had a trigger. Okay, the final example, I went ahead and I accounted for one further element. Okay, so we have one extra tag. So possible phishing fraud. So this one was achieved by using a combination of email impersonation and domain age. Okay, so we recently added a domain age feature where if a domain is younger than 90 days, we will mark that email. Okay, and here via combination of those two elements added by email.cloud, I managed to then get an extra verdict added to the email. Okay, let me see. Okay, I don't know if there are any queries at this point regarding this section. So I'll pass the ball back to Sarita.
Great, actually, I'm going to pick that up, Roberto. Thank you. So thanks for that demo. I'm going to just start by for a couple of minutes just talking about email fraud protection. I see we're getting some questions in around spam and authentication. This might help a bit with that, but I know we'll certainly have time at the end. So I just want to talk a little bit about the problem that many customers are talking to us about DMARC, particularly getting to DMARC enforcement. I think this slide encapsulates the problem, which is if you try to do this yourself, it's hard. it doesn't tend to work. It takes a long time. And the reason is that when you go for DMARC enforcement, really you're trying to put your arms around every single email that's going out from an approved list of senders. But we know the world is complex. it's, for example, in Broadcom, not every Broadcom branded email will come from a Broadcom organization. We might subcontract some of that to, for example, payroll or marketing agencies, etc. So it's hard to do that, especially if you're global and working in a virtual organization way where you have different suppliers in different regions and so on. And so we see customers, have good intentions to get to DMARC enforcement, but they struggle to get there. We see some organizations offering help in the middle with a consultative approach where they offer manpower and expertise to get you to a point of DMARC enforcement. But unfortunately, maintaining that can be as hard as getting there. And so, again, we see many projects which may have started DMARC enforcement failing. So we've built an automated way to help organizations do that. It reduces a lot of the complexity. It speeds up time. And in fact, we've had many successes with customers who've tried one of the left approaches and taken our email fraud protection product to help them reach DMARC enforcement. I think it's really impossible to say that when it comes to scanning inbound email, and if you remember that flowchart picture that Roberto showed, we do check for sender authentication. So we're doing that anyway as part of our standard security gateway. But this is about for all the outbound email you're sending, really to protect your own brand. So let me just show sort of a few flowcharts how that works. So really here you're seeing kind of this problem set up. You're seeing many different entities sending email over a particular domain. And how do we know which ones of these to trust? We've got maybe third-party senders, which may or may not be legitimate. They may have valid reasons, or they may be sending out of contract. We have our own internal organization, maybe using cloud systems. And of course, we're open to attack. Now, to check the authentication, we need to check with the DNS. Now, one of the areas of difficulty is actually liaising from a messaging team with the web team to update the DNS and keep that up to date. There are also some issues, for example, with SPF, there's a 10 limit lookup. With our solution, we ask that organization adds a line to DNS to refer to email fraud protection. And so email fraud protection now has that list of all the approved senders. So the customers' DNS records has asked email fraud protection, and we can do this check. And at the same time, we're checking against all known or many of the email sending services. So as they change, we keep those up to date. And indeed, if you were to add or remove legitimate third-party senders, you can make those changes in the email fraud protection product without having to make any DNS changes. So that then comes back with a response, and we then provide to the email gateway the information to allow them to know whether to deliver that email or to reject or quarantine it. And so all of this then provides organizations with a good deal of comfort, a good deal of trust, and trust that they can share with their recipients. So, for example, if you're a bank or a healthcare organization, a pharmaceutical, you know that others won't be able to send email out on your email brand because you've got protection there. It also means, if you think back to some of those impersonation risks, that it's very hard for an organization to pretend to be a senior officer in your own organization and spoof yourself, because if they haven't come from with those sender authentication standards, then we know there's going to be an issue there. So I just wanted to kind of illustrate a little about email fraud protection. We have more information in the attachments. As I said, we're seeing some questions coming in, so that's great to see, and we'll make sure we have time at the end to cover those. Sarita, why don't I hand back to you to talk about URL exploits, and I know you've got a demonstration to share as well.
Thanks, Sunil. So what I would like to do is focus on URL exploits that I was talking about earlier. So far, we have covered BEC scam and how impersonation controls and email fraud protection play an important part in fighting against BEC. Now, I would like to discuss URL-based exploits and what are the defenses we have in email security solution. So here are the five top layers of protection that we offer through email security. First is, as discussed by my colleagues, we have email impersonation controls, and enforcing DMARC standard helps deliver email only from trusted senders. So that's the first layer of protection. Second, Symantec email security ensures that emails are scanned at delivery time as well as at click time. So using our link following, we follow links through to the final destination, even when they are using evasion techniques like multi-hops, short URLs, or redirections. We scan them both at delivery and click time. We also here leverage the power of our web intelligence solution, which gives high quality decisions, real-time decisions on web page safety. The next layer of protection is to train employees, again, to identify the sophisticated phishing emails. These could be BEC type of emails, or these could be emails with URLs embedded with them. So training the users within an organization helps them, helps them keep up with the sophistication of the emails that scammers are using. So phishing awareness is part of our email security solution. The fourth layer of protection that we offer is isolation of suspicious URLs or attachments using our leading email threat isolation solution. So isolation, what it does is it renders a suspicious site in read-only mode so that users cannot accidentally give away sensitive data. It also prevents malware from directly being downloaded to a user's endpoint, because isolation is rendered in a remote container. So it creates an insulation between the user's endpoint and the malicious site. So overall, isolation provides secure access to uncategorized or risky sites, and it's quite frankly a true protection against zero-day exploits. And finally, last but not the least, email telemetry is a very powerful feature within emailsecurity.cloud. So what we do is, through our APIs, our customers can export data from email security. And how this is useful is security analysts or SOC teams can integrate these APIs into their SIM or SOAR platforms. And they essentially use this data to detect and remediate threats. Part of this telemetry, we provide information on both blocked URLs, URLs that have been detected by the system as malicious or suspicious. We give information on those type of URLs, as well as we provide information on clean URLs. And clean URL data is particularly helpful. A security analyst can correlate clean URL information with any other URL threat feeds. And if they find that a clean URL has turned suspicious or malicious at the click time, or by cross-correlating with the threat intelligence feeds, they are able to identify the users within their organization who have received the supposedly clean URLs. So that's the power of telemetry that we actually give from the product. Another major improvement that we have recently introduced is we now give targeted attack analytics as part of our email security cloud solution. Targeted attack analytics helps security teams, SOC analysts, to be able to identify the campaigns conducted on their organization and what are the top indicators for each campaign. They're able to identify the most attacked people within their organization for a given campaign, who are the bad or offending senders, where did the campaign originate from, and how does that particular campaign compare with the rest of the Symantec customers within our install base. So these are the analytics. It's a very powerful feature that's available through our management console as well as via APIs. And it really helps security analysts in terms of prioritizing their remediation efforts. So with that, I'd like to move on to this view of URL isolation and how it works in action. This is just a recap of what I was talking before. So let's say there is an email with a malicious URL that is sent. First, we check at the time of delivery. We check for the URL risk. And if it is a bad email known at the delivery time, then we block it right away. At the time of delivery, if it is determined to be good, it gets delivered to the user. And when the user clicks on the link, we use the link following technology, and we block the email if it is known to be a bad website or it has turned malicious after the delivery. Now, if the URL is uncategorized, because maybe it is a new URL that has not built enough categorization information, or it may be a URL where it is a shareware site, or it's an object storage size where, you know, people are constantly uploading software, and the some of these URLs, they do not they remain as uncategorized even though they have been around for quite some time. So for those kind of URLs which are uncategorized, we then use our isolation technology to let users safely browse through the website without the risk of giving away their phishing credentials or downloading malware, because isolation executes in a remote container. So these are the three main layers of defense that we have within the email security cloud solution. Now, I would like to show them in action a couple of points. One is email threat analytics or email threat campaigns, and the other one is email threat isolation solution. All right. So what I'm showing here is our ClientNet management console for email security cloud. And as you can see, we have, as part of email threat detection and response feature, we have email threat analytics. What you're seeing is a high-level aggregated view of all the campaigns that an organization has encountered in the past 15 days. And these campaigns can be mass, focused, or highly focused. Mass campaigns generally go out to a large number of users. Highly focused are a targeted number of users. So I'd like to take one of the examples here. For this mass campaign, the views here, they show what is the number of globally attacked organizations with respect to this campaign. And by the way, a campaign is a set of emails used as part of a targeted attack, and they share a common set of traits. And these get grouped together as a campaign. So the analytics page shows various interesting details, such as where did the attack originate from? What are the IP addresses that are used for the attack? It shows what are the top indicators for the campaign, such as who's the sender, what are the various subject lines where that are found by this campaign, etc. It also shows what are the top domains that are attacked and top email addresses that are attacked within the campaign. So this really helps an analyst in terms of identifying most attacked people within an organization. And it also shows the attack timeline. When did it originate and how has it progressed since then? So these type of features, again, are very useful to SOC analysts in terms of prioritizing the remediation efforts and reducing the exposure time to a particular targeted attack. Now, I would like to switch attention to email threat isolation. Enabling email threat isolation is very simple. It's as simple as clicking a checkbox. URL isolation can be enabled with this simple checkbox, and we also have a similar setting for attachment isolation, where they can, you know, simply enable this checkbox and that attachment isolation can be deployed into your organization. We also enable offline, allow offline access of our attachments, because we realize that sometimes attachments need to be available even when there is no internet connection. So as you can see, it's very easy to turn on isolation. Now let's see isolation in action. What I have here is an email in my test inbox, and it contains various different types of URLs. Some are low risk and some are unknown risk. Now, low risk URLs, if a user clicks on a low risk URL like BBC News, if I hover my a cursor over the URL, you can see that it has been rewritten. So what this means is at the time of click, our engines will reevaluate the URL for the safety. And this being a safe URL, a user is redirected to the safe website immediately, and there is no user experience issue or anything. Now, at the same time, let me go back to my email again. Let me click on this unknown risk URL. When I do this, this is a European shareware website where constantly new types of music or other software gets uploaded. So I would, when I click on this website, it is deemed uncategorized. So let's see the experience here. So our engine is evaluating this particular website. And as you can see from the address bar here, it has been redirected to an isolated container. From the user experience perspective, one cannot distinguish that this is being rendered in a read-only mode, right? Now pretend this is a phishing website and a user is being asked to give credentials, and I start typing something in the search bar here. I get a notification saying that you are viewing this website in protected view. Are you sure you want to give away your credentials? And user can then consciously choose to give away the credentials because they trust the site, or they can simply close this and proceed to just browsing the website. If this were to be a malware site, then it it prevents download of any malware from this website to user's endpoint. So this is how isolation, it's easy to turn on, very easy to use in real time. And it protects from both phishing as well as malware in real time. Right. And that concludes the demo portion of my presentation. So let me, I will turn it over. All right.
Sarita, that's great. Yeah, thank you. I'll pick up from here. That's brilliant. And I think really that demo shows a very good way that, let me just put some slides back on, a very good way that, if I just go back here, that these two technologies come back in. So we talked about BEC, and then we talked about some of that phishing prevention. And if you remember right at the start, we're saying one of those BEC problems was account takeover. And I think here we've shown these two things almost playing together. So thank you very much for that. I just wanted to take a couple of minutes just to remind the audience about the breadth of our portfolio. Just a few points here, and you will have copies of the slides. So one is that, you know, I think one of the things that our customers appreciate from Symantec is we have both cloud and appliance versions of our technology. So really, we can help customers plan their migration. We have licenses which gives them access to both. We have a multi-tenant cloud architecture set around the world to really deliver that performance and scale customers are looking for. And as I'm sure you've seen, within our solution, we have the ability to protect from all manner of attacks. You know, the table stakes of malware and spam, right through to phishing attacks, credential theft, ransomware, business email compromise. We have sandboxing technology, and really doubling down our efforts and investment in analytics. And you saw some of those latest views from Sarita, which I think was really helpful. Just as we get ready to answer some of your questions, and we've already seen questions coming in, and I know Roberto's got itching to share an answer there. Before I do that, let me just kind of break it back to, you know, three things we recommend. And these aren't just technology. These are kind of in broad brackets. Of course, we do have links to our technology where it's relevant. So I think the first thing, particularly around these complex attacks, BC, is that account takeover problem. There are ways we can lower the phishing risk. We've seen some of those link following, checking links at click time, not just delivery time, using the web intelligence that Symantec has available with its leading portfolio of web security products. Isolation, I think Sarita just gave an excellent example of that. But don't forget there are other layers of protection with things like CASB and identity protection. And really understand the web page risk. So again, you know, click time, link following, using isolation. But also, I think, you know, really interesting, Sarita, you know, I think you showed one of the things that we've thought hard about, which is how do we make this technology easy? I think, you know, as we monitor the market, we think we look to market predictions. I think one of the things we're wondering about, I'm sure you're wondering about, is what will the world look like post-COVID? And from a security point of view, maybe that means, you know, organizations have less budget to spend on everything, let alone on security. So we might start seeing some budget pressure. We might start seeing difficulty in getting skills. We may see organizations having invested faster than planned to become cloud ready and remote. And so that's taken cycles out of what they would be spending on from a security point of view. So we believe our approach of making that simple to deploy and manage will help. And then all around user behavior. I mean, this is as broad as the security culture, but there are ways, and I think Roberto showed how we can take information analytics we know about email and how we can mark up for the user. You know, and really, I think I'd say two things. One is, if we know we shouldn't deliver that email, it's much better we don't. That avoids confusion. If we can't make a good determination, then we can help users make better decisions. And even if they decide to click a link, we can put good information and protection in place. So I might just leave this slide up whilst we work through some of those questions. I think one of the questions was asked around SMG, but if you don't mind, I'm going to kind of just take the essence of that question and talk in the general terms. What we will do, though, is for the person who asked that question, we'll follow up with specific information around SMG if it varies from what Roberto's asking about. But really, the question is around domain spoofing. So the question is, how would they be able to prevent domain spoofing, particularly for lookalike domains or domains which link to, you know, very popular and generally known good websites like Google or Gmail? And Roberto, I don't know if you want to jump in and kind of share some thoughts here.
Yes, thank you, Sunil. Yes, on this topic, so we do have, at least for email.cloud, so part of our anti-spam service, so we do type of squatting. So in this case, lookalike domain, so is called type of squatting, and we do some type of squatting, so to help protect exactly for these type of lookalike domains.
Great, excellent. I think the other thing which was coming to my mind is, and this probably sort of stretches out beyond the isolation capabilities within our product, but I know you know, there are other links here around, you know, maybe, for example, documents which are shared on a document sharing site or even a webmail. And there are use cases around full web isolation which support this. So typically, customers are looking to allow staff access to maybe their personal Gmail. They know there's nothing wrong with the Gmail website, if you like, web domain, but they're wondering what risk the contents of those emails may contain. And so that could be a good use case to isolate that particular, if you like, web application that would be beyond the scope of email isolation, but is certainly something that Symantec could help with through a full web isolation capability.
Correct. Because in this case, it's not really the reputation of the root domain, is the reputation of the link as a whole. So googlegroups.com, it's fine. Similarly with SharePoint from Microsoft, it's also a good link. So the root domain is perfectly fine. So the reputation here is given to the link as a whole. So Google Groups / something, something, something file, or it ends up on a particular page. So is that link as a whole that we assign a reputation to and not just the root domain. So googlegroups.com is perfectly fine. However, a particular link that may lead to a bad page or a page that has a bad file, that particular link will have a bad reputation, while googlegroups.com by itself is not affected.
Fantastic. Thank you for that. Another question coming in, and may Rebecca, sorry to put you in the hot seat. I think this one's for you. So it was around, I think you talked about BC and the Business Email Scam Analyzer. Someone saying they weren't really aware of that option or how to turn it on. And is that a special license they need, or how would they access that?
No, so BEC already comes with a base email.cloud service. So in this case, the minimum that you need to have is email safeguard. So that comes with anti-spam, antivirus, data protection, and email impersonation will be there. Okay, cool. So if you don't know where to find it, just reach out to the support teams and they will help you.
Perfect. That's great. And just looking at time, we might have time for one more question. If you have asked questions and we haven't had a chance to answer those, we will follow up with you offline after this event. And maybe if I can just do a last reminder that within the attachments tab, there's lots of useful information. And of course, we'd love for you to take just a couple of seconds to rate this webinar as well and let us know how you found it, how was the content. Anything you'd like to see different, anything you'd like to see us cover in a future webinar. Sarita, one question which came in, you may or may not be able to answer it, was just around, what can we expect next? And what's the direction that we see, our email security products going in? We've talked about lots of different technology. I think people just wondering what might be the next things they can look for. We may or may not be able to answer that. Just thought I'd put that question out there.
Absolutely. So email security is a key element of network security protection suite. So we are making investments in multiple areas. One is, we will continue to invest on our leading threat intelligence platform. So we continue our efficacy leadership, help our customers in fighting against email-based threats. And so that is an area of continual investment for us. And then some of the investments that we are going to be making around this year, going into next year, is around our telemetry. We are focused on areas such as integrating into SOAR platforms, publishing additional telemetry that will help with the security operations automation use cases. So that's another area of investment as well. And we are seeing an uptick in isolation adoption with our customers. So if we will be investing in isolation to make sure that any customers get more choices to control isolation on their end. So these are the three primary areas just off the top of my head, in terms of our investment direction with respect to email security.
Well, Sarita, Roberto, thank you very much. And thank you to our audience for taking the time out, joining us on another webinar. Maybe that's, lots of webinars I'm sure you've been doing over the last few months. And before we sign off, really just a reminder, if you could take a second or two to rate today's webinar, don't forget there's all the material for you available. Thank you once again for your time. Thank you, Sarita and Roberto, for those demonstrations. I think you really brought the topics to life. And I look forward to seeing this audience on a future webinar. So stay safe and see you soon. Bye.
Thank you all. Stay safe.